Now, the President Ouyen Chan and Mr. Bill Gates has arrived. So please welcome him with a big applause.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
So before I sit, I'll make a brief announcement. Well, my name is Wei Li. I'm Dean of Engineering, and I'm very pleased to have here with Mr. Bill Gates and with you. I mean, well, first, I'd like to apologize for my appearance like this, with one arm in a sling, and well, I was pretty much excited to see Mr. Bill Gates face to face. So I tried to practice handshake with him. But the problem was, maybe I did too much to end up with like this. Well, I'm not sure if I have to introduce Mr. Bill Gates to you. He's so famous. He's probably one of the most successful entrepreneurs in history. He's known for Microsoft, his passion for software design, he's a computer guru, but most importantly, he's a great humanist with warm heart, caring for people in need. And on top of all that, he loves to talk to young people like you sitting here. So please welcome Bill Gates again. Well, whenever we invite distinguished guests, we always check the protocols in every detail. The first thing we do is to check how the guest, our guest, wants to be addressed. In this case, it was a little bit more special because he held so many important titles during his long successful career, president, chairman, and many, many other titles. So we naturally asked him, and the response was very simple. It was just simply Bill. So you can call him Bill when you ask questions.
Please.
And I believe this is how he wants this session to be proceeded. No frills, right down to the point, and most importantly, in a friendly atmosphere and a comfortable manner. So my role, one more thing to add. My role as a moderator is to set the table. So to break the ice, I prepare some questions myself out of personal interest, but the interest, I'm sure, that is shared by most of the audience. So, let me sit. So,
please.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay. So, Bill, it is my pleasure to welcome you to Seoul Asian University, and the enthusiasm that our faculty members and students show for this session is phenomenal, like you witness here and along the way to here. We are honored to have the opportunity to listen to your vision on the future of innovation and the bold and hopeful work you set through your, say, far-reaching philanthropic effort. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation is bringing transformative changes in enhancing healthcare, reducing poverty, and expanding educational opportunities. Since leaving Microsoft, you have been dedicating your time in finding innovative solutions to some of the world's, say, toughest challenges in the areas such as agriculture, energy, and infectious diseases. So I'm sure your visit to Korea is related to one or multiple of these issues. So could you please share with us the purpose of your Korean visit briefly?
Well, I'm excited to be here. I haven't actually been to Korea for 5 years. So the last time I was here was the last year I was working full time as part of Microsoft. And of course, Microsoft brought me here a number of times because a lot of the key partners, whether it was LG, Samsung, so many key partners here in Korea who helped make personal computing a reality and did such a good job making the internet low cost and available to everyone. So that's not the primary focus this time. This time my focus is more related to the foundation work and the work of a startup company looking at nuclear energy called TerraPower. And for the foundation, as you mentioned, the focus is on global health, and agriculture. Mm-hmm. You know, the innovation in general it has a way of sometimes going to the people who are the best off. And so we have to work extra hard to think about what type of innovation we need for those who are the worst off, the poorest. You know, many of those are farmers with small plots of land, and many of those people are still experiencing conditions that, you know, we almost take for granted isn't happening. For example, if you're a baby born in a poor country, you have a 50 times greater chance of dying than you do in a rich country. So we ought to be able to take science, whether it's health science or digital tools, and improve that. And so, you know, I'm here to connect with the great engineering and science talent that's in the country. I'll get to talk with the president about you know, her ambitious agenda for the country and see what projects in health or agriculture or energy might be an alignment. So it's a great chance to understand, you know, what innovation here matches up with my new full-time work.
Okay. All right, thank you. Maybe students can ask more about your answer. Yes. Well, my next question is about the education and, say, creative capital. Your visit comes at a very important time for both Seoul National University and the nation of Korea. Well, and let me explain why. A little bit over 40 years ago, Korea was the poorest country in the world. By mid-90s, somehow we were able to pull ourselves from the poverty, out of poverty, by becoming a manufacturing powerhouse. But however, as we enter the 21st century, there is a deep realization that the old formula for past success may not work anymore for the future. In order to become a, say, world-class economy, we may need different set of skills. So we have been pretty good at, say, produce something. However, in the future, it is the ability to create something that will say foster innovation. So we have to move from, say, produce to create. We are in a very, say, serious phase of transition. And actually we have a, say, new government for about 2 months, and our new president's top priority is on so-called, say, creative economy. So the ability to spur creativity is one of the, say, toughest challenges for educational institutions like us, as well as the biggest opportunity for us. Though Korea is praised as having one of the, say, brightest students worldwide, at the same time, many people advise us that we need a culture that judges success on a wider range of criteria beyond just test scores. And we need to have, say, more free-thinking, creative, graduate students as well. So along the same vein, dropping out of prestigious schools such as Harvard would be almost unthinkable for most Koreans, especially for Korean parents, I believe. So could you please share with us the reasons behind why you dropped out of Harvard, and more importantly, do you believe that creativity can be, say, taught or learned at school?
Oh, that's a great question. You know, my parents at first weren't super happy that I was dropping out.
Of course.
You know, they had been super supportive in terms of paying for me to go to a private high school that was very good, and then also paying for my tuition at Harvard. And I'd been there a couple of years when the opportunity to create Microsoft came along. And it was a very unique opportunity. You know, the microprocessor that is putting the computer on a chip was changing the rules of the game in a way that if you've been around in the computer industry in a way you might miss it. you know, because you would always think of computers as being expensive, but they were changing to be very inexpensive, and therefore their character was changing. It wasn't just numeric difference, it was a qualitative difference in terms of it becoming a personal tool. And so amazingly, companies like IBM or even Wang or Digital, who'd been innovators, didn't see where computing was going. And so because my friend Paul Allen and I did, you know, we wanted to be the first to get out there and write software. And so I didn't have time to finish my degree. And so I dropped out and started Microsoft. You know, I don't recommend that path for other people. You know, it's possible that it's the right thing to do, but it's better for it to be the exception than the rule. You know, in most cases, there's nothing so urgent that needs to get done. You know, in terms of the president's message about the opportunity Korea has to make this huge contribution, I completely agree with that. It is a phenomenal story that really only one country has gone from being a significant aid recipient to now turning around and starting to be quite a generous aid donor. I get to meet with the National Assembly tomorrow morning, and I'll talk a little bit about this story and encourage them to move even more aggressively to up the great levels of generosity. In some ways, when you're following other models of what other countries have done, it's easier. You know, so following what Japan did or some things the United States did, you know, that was the right path. Now, clearly both the companies here and institutions here have gotten to a world-class level. And so there really is, in a sense, no one to follow. You know, if you want to innovate in agriculture or health or material science or any type of energy, including nuclear energy, you have to be looking at the absolute frontiers. Just being able to make the, whatever somebody else made at a slightly better price, which is a huge value, and you don't ever want to forget how to do that. You know, the United States has a big thing now that we need to get back into manufacturing, because if you don't have that hands-on understanding, you sometimes will miss where you can do the innovation. So you don't want to give up that current strength, but you do want to have this ability to take risk and innovate. And we've certainly seen it on the internet. You know, there have been so many new things that were tried first in Korea on the internet, because you got the price down, you got the bandwidth, you got the penetration up. You know, that's an incredible thing. And then many of your leading companies are very innovative. You know, I think creativity, it comes partly from having a breadth of knowledge. And so you don't want to just learn one area of study. You know, for me, the thing that was always fun was to know, you know, a bit about chemistry, physics, biology, math. In computer science, you don't have to know that much math. But the more math you know, the better off it is. So being very broad, and always thinking through, trying to understand what are the problems that need to be solved. You know, for me, even understanding what is practical to do in a poor country, I have to make three or four trips a year out and see, okay, which of these ideas we thought would really work in the poor countries to help them out, which ones are really working, which ones need to be changed. You can't always know in advance. I also think being young is a great thing for being creative, because you do have this way of looking at things from scratch. And you know, so much of science today, our ability to model things, our ability to look at large amounts of data, people who come of age taking that for granted will be able to do things that people whose education was even just 10 years ago, they don't have that idea that we should be looking at all this data and finding patterns in these very rich ways. So in the same way that mathematics was sort of the handmaiden of all the sciences traditionally, today computer science, in particular data-driven learning things, are becoming a fairly key thing across many fields. And so it's interesting, if you're an undergraduate, the number of things that you should study is almost too many. One thing that, you know, has helped me a lot is continuing to study things even after I left the full-time educational environment. And of course today, with the resources that are online, the ability to watch lectures from anywhere in the world and to, you know, stay in touch if you're confused about something, you know, be able to get straightened out about it. It's an unbelievable time to maintain that ongoing curiosity throughout your 20s, 30s, and even later. So, you know, the fact that people do well on test scores, that is a necessary but not sufficient part of the equation.
Okay. All right, thank you very much. And here's my last question. It's on entrepreneurship and innovation. Well, in the 2009 annual letter at the foundation, you wrote about the importance of innovation and how we can make the difference between a bleak future and a bright one. Well, I'm sure you faced many challenges while you were at, say, Microsoft, and still you do as you move forward in finding solutions to the, say, world's toughest challenges. So could you please share with us how you tackle these challenges and how innovation worked in the process?
Well, when Microsoft got started, the idea was that, you know, software was magic and that most people didn't care much about software. They didn't realize how important software was. And, you know, so if the hardware was going to be cheap, the microprocessor, the disk, the communications through optic fiber, then the only limiting factor was going to be the quality of the software. And the software, in terms of how it let you navigate data, the entire idea of the user interface, you know, mouse, touch, handwriting, speech, was going to be this very critical thing that we had to make machines that didn't require that much learning to be able to work with them. The computers before Microsoft came along were only for professionals and, you know, extremely complex. And that was okay because there not many people needed to work with them. And so we had, you know, the idea of personal computing and user interface. We got to try so many different things. And the nice thing is you get a lot of feedback from people using the product about what they like, what they don't like. And so if you can get into that situation where you have a test set of users who are telling you what's wrong, and then you understand fundamentally what the big leaps are going to be, you know, that's the ideal. Lots of immediate feedback, but then looking to where there can be a paradigm shift. A big paradigm shift for Microsoft was the move to graphical interface. And, you know, today everybody takes it for granted that your screen is just sort of an arbitrary display. But in those days, literally until 1995, that way of doing things was so slow and so much more complicated than just putting up text on the screen that many people questioned whether it would ever be the right thing. And a lot of Microsoft success came from totally betting the company on this graphic interface. And then the internet came along. Many people, you know, that was a real change in terms of how you thought about the key applications. And we further strengthened the company by actually revolutionizing ourselves and saying, okay, we're going to build around the internet. You know, now the frontiers are even more interesting. You know, will it be speech? Will it be pen? You know, will the devices move around? You know, will there be lots of robots and things? How do we think about machine learning, where the machine, based on a lot of experiences, can figure out how to work in a more intelligent way? So the frontiers are still out there. You know, for the individual person, though, knowing these scenarios, what you're trying to get done and why it's not possible, I think is what's very key. And you're always applying your curiosity to say, why hasn't that been done? Why is it so hard? Why hasn't anybody done things that way? And, you know, if you're relentless about that, you always find a solution.
Right. So... So please don't forget that I was one of the first customers of your, say, PC-DOS or MS-DOS at the time. Yeah,
right.
That was PC-DOS, I think, when I was a graduate
student. That was character text mode, yeah.
Okay. Well, I think we are going to take some questions from the, say, audience.
Good.
So this session is supposed to be to last for about, say, 50 minutes, so we have a little bit over 30 minutes. So we have to be rather strict on the schedule, I think. So when you ask questions, please be concise so that we can hear more from him, okay? Yeah, thank you. So any question?
I'm Ryu Shin Ho, junior student of Nuclear Engineering Department, and I was wondering what do you expect in cooperation with Korea about TWR, and how do you think about the future of nuclear power industry?
Thank you. Well, I think energy is fundamental. If you look at, you know, why the world has made so much progress in the last several hundred years, which is quite phenomenal, you know, one of the key breakthroughs was the availability of energy. Mm-hmm. My favorite sort of science author is Václav Smil, and he writes very eloquently about the energy generations we've gone through, and you know, how that was central to the innovation that's taken place. And so we definitely need to constantly make energy cheaper. You know, Korea's done a good job. Actually, the cost of energy here, electrical energy, is quite low compared to many other countries. And part of that is what you've done in the nuclear field. I think as we look forward, you know, the energy we want has to be environmentally friendly. That is, no CO2 emission, or if it emits CO2, some way that's captured and sequestered. Mm-hmm. So no net CO2 emission. And it has to be lower cost than energy is today. Because if you think about poor people and their desire to buy fertilizer or travel or have light or heat, a lot of the basic needs of those in poverty are cost as much as whatever energy costs. And for them today, particularly when they don't have a grid, the energy is unreliable, you have to transport diesel fuel. It's a mm-hmm. quite a tough situation. And so I think we need to back lots of different energy innovators. You know, the different technologies all have challenges. Things like wind and solar could be very important in the future. They're fairly small today, but they're intermittent, and they're only available in certain locations. Okay. And so issues like storage mm-hmm. and very large, low-cost mm-hmm. storage are very difficult there. In the case of nuclear, there are many challenges. You know, we have to bring costs down. We have to make sure people feel comfortable about the safety. We have to reduce the waste that's created, and for whatever waste we do create, we need to have clear solutions. So I think it's one of the areas that we should invest in new innovation. And I think there hasn't been enough innovation in that area. You know, mm-hmm. in fact, you know, in the 1970s and 80s, things really were not invested in a very big way. I think because of digital simulation, our opportunity to look at new approaches is more exciting today than ever before. And so there's a company I'm involved with called TerraPower that has a new approach. And it's at the very beginning of a dialogue with companies around the world, including as part of this trip, some here in Korea, about what are their ideas about the future of nuclear, what are our ideas, are there ways that we could bring these together and create a generation even beyond what's being built today. Today is called third generation, mm-hmm. but the idea would be a fourth generation whose safety and waste characteristics and all the key characteristics would be much better than anything we have today. So, you know, I'm a believer there is an opportunity there, and we'll have to see, you know, how that comes together. But, you know, we need better energy technologies. We mm-hmm. cannot just simply mm-hmm. keep burning coal and natural gas, which is the primary where, particularly for the new generation that's being installed mm-hmm. in places like India and China, which are adding so many power plants. So, mm-hmm. you know, because I believe that climate change is a huge problem, mm-hmm. that's one of the things we have to deal with. And in terms of baseband reliable power that emits no CO2, nuclear could fit in there if we manage to have the breakthrough path that mm-hmm. reduces the challenges.
So you still see as nuclear power as the only alternative we have for the future energy funding?
We need to pursue any, you know, we need hundreds of companies like TerraPower that have, you know, a wild new idea that's fantastic. Mm-hmm. And then we should play those out, you know. Mm-hmm. Those companies should find partners, they should deploy them. You know, nobody knows the single answer to this. Mm-hmm. And there's even approaches, there's one called solar chemical that very few people are working on right now. Mm-hmm. But that's where you take natural sunlight and you cause a chemical reaction mm-hmm. that creates some sort of hydrocarbon. The nice thing about that approach is that it has its own storage solution built in, because it actually, you know, mm-hmm. creates a chemical liquid, say, like gasoline, that has a very high energy density and has a transportability. Mm-hmm. So you get around mm-hmm. the intermittency storage type problems by doing it that way. So now I believe that we should pursue all these approaches, because mm-hmm. if we don't change our energy system mm-hmm. To be both lower cost and non-CO2, you know, the problems we're going to get into, although there's some range of uncertainty, that the potential problems are quite severe. And the people who suffer the most from that are the poor farmers who don't have mm-hmm. storage, you know, mm-hmm. they mm-hmm. don't have drought-resistant crops, they don't have irrigation. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, they who caused the problem not at all, mm-hmm. and they weren't involved in the greenhouse CO2 emission, they're the ones who will suffer. And so that's, you know, deeply unjust if, mm-hmm. if that's mm-hmm. the way it ends up.
Okay, all right.
My name is Xin Bo Gyeong, and I am majoring in animal biotechnology. I heard that Melinda and Bill Gates Foundation biologically engineered vitamin A as a way to help children in Africa. And I was wondering if decision also took consideration the development of biotechnology.
Yeah, the foundation is very involved in different aspects of biotechnology, biotechnology for health and biotechnology for agriculture. And, you know, for us, we're the biggest investor in new vaccines, things like a malaria vaccine, a tuberculosis vaccine. We're the second biggest for an AIDS vaccine. The U.S. government's actually the biggest investor in that. In terms of crops, you know, we need far more productivity, and we need crops that can deal with drought, that require less fertilizer, you know, a lot of neat characteristics that need to be created, including disease resistance. One that's of particular importance that you mentioned is putting vitamins, the micronutrients, actually into the crops. A lot of African children have huge micronutrition deficiencies, vitamin A, iron, quite a few different things. And we don't have any really easy way to get that into their diet. With iodine, we were able to do it with salt. So most people actually get iodized enhanced salt, and that solved a lot of the problems you get if you don't have enough iodine. But with these other nutrients, the easiest way to do it would be to put it into their staple crops. So to put it into the grains mm-hmm. or other things they eat. So we did, for example, a sweet potato that has iron fortification. We have a rice that we fund that actually has vitamin A increase, so-called golden rice. That's a very good thing. Mm-hmm. Now, what that means is that some of these new crops are created through techniques of genetic engineering. And so you get all the questions people have about, well, will they be low cost for the poor farmers? Will there be any side effects? How will you make mm-hmm. sure, in the same way that we test medicines to make sure they don't have any negative effects, you know, how are you going to test and make sure these things are okay? You get all those problems. But we think those problems are very worth taking on, because the benefits of having these much better crops, literally the kind of micronutrition deficiency that African children have means that about 30% of them, their brains never fully develop. And so no matter how much is put into education or mm-hmm. They simply can't achieve their potential. And that's awful, both for the individual mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. for the country. And so, you know, we're looking for innovations having to do with nutrition in any way possible, including these magic seeds.
Okay. So, yeah.
Hi. Hi, Bill. I'm a professor at School of Electrical and Computer Engineering. Actually, you are my old boss because I worked for Microsoft Research at Redmond as a visiting scientist in the past. And it's a great honor to have you here. Can you share your thoughts on what are strong and weak points of Korean software industry in your experiences?
Well, a little bit, the software industry isn't, you know, country by country quite as much as it used to be. I mean, there are companies that are started originally in one country, but it's actually pretty amazing today how, you know, say for somebody like Microsoft, the development centers are incredibly worldwide, particularly as we bought different companies, we've grown all our groups in Asia quite a bit. You can't really say that it's just a US-based software company. Mm-hmm. Korea has benefited from the fact that internet penetration here happened very early. You know, so the idea of getting your TV shows and having this integration of media, bringing a way of looking at interactive games, there's a lot of great innovation on those issues here in Korea. Now there's always a question, what does that mean? Does that mean those companies grow up to be global champions, or does it mean they stay domestic champions, or does it mean that they get bought up as part of a different company, or the worst case is they come up with a really good idea and they're not the ones who takes it to the world, but it's simply a model. You know, all of those things are a contribution, and so, you know, I'd say over the last decade there's been a lot of very innovative stuff that's happened in Korea. It's a small enough percentage of the world market, though. You want to think about, okay, how do you get it out to other places? Particularly, you know, as although Korea's been out in front on internet penetration, now other countries really are catching up. It's not, mm-hmm. you know, totally unique. Even in China today, you know, China has more internet users than the U.S. has people. So it's going to be hard for us to ever match them in terms of internet users ever again. And that, you know, for the U.S. it's weird because we're used to our customers being the most demanding customers. Mm-hmm. And that helps fuel things. Now in many areas, both IT, certainly in energy, the biggest customer base, at least new activity, is going to be outside the U.S. That's very interesting. So, you know, for software, the only other model besides the U.S. model, which is very venture capital driven, small, high-risk startup driven, the only other model has been the Indian model, which is very services-oriented, and that's been extremely successful for them. Interestingly, in terms of products, they haven't done as well. The other model, you could say, third model, is China, where because of a variety of reasons, their internet companies have not been as subject to international competition, and so they've been innovating within the Chinese market. Now, so far, basically none of those companies have moved outside of China in any broad way, and so it's just a one-way, you know, type situation. So I'd say, you know, if whatever software innovation you have to think about how eventually you want it to go global. You can test it out in a local market, but you have to have some way to have the highest impact of, you know, what are you going to do about the U.S., mm-hmm. China, mm-hmm. Japanese, the other very, very big markets. And so far, that hasn't been easily tackled.
Okay.
Oh my God, I'm very, very appreciative of you. And okay, thank you very much. And I'm Eun Hyun Ji, majoring in the water harvest science biology. Yes, and I want to ask you how do you think about the personalized general service? Because it is very well received attention about 22nd and me. You know that service. And I think it is very helpful about the worldwide human health, and it is what is your interest. Okay, thank you.
Well, genomics is changing health sciences very, very dramatically, and it's also changing agricultural science. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, on the agricultural side, we're very lucky that plants have the same genetic structure as humans, because all this great instrumentation, these complete genomics, Illumina, mm-hmm. these great machines are designed because the human health market is so gigantic. Mm-hmm. And it's just a windfall to to people who worry about plant productivity, plant disease, we can just take that and do the same type of work. A few weeks ago, I was down meeting with the BGI, which is the Chinese group that has more sequencing machines than any other place in the world. And it's pretty phenomenal how the cost is coming down and how the deep insights about you know, things like cancer, you know, how are the different cancers, you know, how, what are they caused, where do we interfere with them. In terms of personal genome, I haven't chosen to have my own genome sequenced. I don't have an interest in that. I have to say, though, if, you know, if I got some disease like cancer, then I would definitely do that, because now we're able to take what look like the same cancer, but by looking at the genetic profile, understand what sort of treatment ought to be applied based on the genetics. And certain drug regimes will work very well for one type of genetic profile, and other types of drugs work for another genetic profile. So that type of targeting of the medicine to the greater genetic specifics, already that's saved quite a few lives. Obviously, our ability to understand deep biology, so-called systems biology, and literally understand the circuitry of the immune system, this genomic data, not just the static sequencing of the gene, but also all the other omics, where you're looking at the dynamic expressions, the protein makeup, those things. It's as we really dig into those that we're going to have fundamental understandings about how all these things work. And it's amazing how little we know today. Even in the area of the infectious diseases we work on, you know, take a disease like tuberculosis. It's not well known how you acquire tuberculosis and how it goes latent. It's not well known how it goes from latent to active. Even the very basic things and these tools, you know, within the next, say, 10 years, we'll have answers to those questions, which will allow us to work on a much better basis. You know, the AIDS vaccine is a very tough problem. And we've had to discover so much about immunology and using tools of genetics to even, you know, make as much progress as we have, which I think will eventually give us a solution. So I'm, you know, a big believer in the genomics revolution. I don't think yet having your individual genome done, if you're healthy, has that much benefit. You know, mostly it'll tell you to worry about some things that aren't all that actionable. Over time, though, as the price comes down, it will start to be, certainly for anybody who's got any sort of health issue, it'll be standard practice, and you know, it's it's phenomenal. It hasn't yet resulted in that many medicines, but we're just at the beginning.
Hi, Bill, and my name is Ken Gong, and I'm a professor in the medicine. Actually, I'm a nuclear medicine physician, and but I'm interested about the energy. And what do you think about the future about the geothermal energies? And the Earth itself has is a nuclear power plant, huge nuclear power plant. If you're deep digging enough, maybe 15 kilometers, if you invest a new way of the digging technology, such as high touch, as evaporating rocks, not just using the drill bit.
Yeah, the number of energy sources that you can potentially go after are quite large. You've got tidal energy, you've got not just wind onshore and offshore, but you have high wind where, you know, if you go up to like 3,000-4,000 feet, you can get jet stream type wind. And geothermal's there in the mix. You know, one of my, other than Smeal, who's the best energy author, he's written so many different books. One of the best books is David Mackay's book, you know, Energy Without the Hot Air, where he really goes through and talks about where we use energy and where the potential source of energy is. And geothermal actually can be part of the mix. It turns out that the heat flux through the crust of the Earth is very finite. And so typically when you go in to do geothermal, you're actually creating a cold spot. That is, you're mining the heat in a way that's not it's not going to sustain itself. There's a few hot spots that are an exception to that. Places like Hawaii or Yellowstone, or there's actually quite a few around the world. Those places, well, Iceland in the extreme case, are very lucky. They, in the local area, could probably get 100% of their energy from geothermal. But at least the way Mackay does the calculations, geothermal's contribution to the overall global energy equation at best would be on the order of 5% or so. So it belongs in the mix, particularly where you have the geology that makes it very attractive. Mm-hmm. It is baseload energy, that is, it's not subject to the wind blowing or the sun shining. It's got a little bit of challenges in terms of you don't want to be polluting water as you're doing it, so that's tricky. Probably solvable. There's been some concern about causing earthquakes, that you're lubricating things. You know, I doubt that's going to be a huge problem to stop it, but it's something that has to be answered. In Switzerland, people who were working on this actually got stopped because they caused a fairly small quake, and so there's some things that we should go through. But it'll be part of the mix, but it's not one of these giant things like solar thermal or solar chemical or solar PV or nuclear, where you could literally provide, you know, close to 100% of global planetary needs through that particular source.
Thank you, Bill. My name is Hyun Kwon from Graduate School of International Studies. I'm focusing my studies on Latin America. But today, my question is hands down on the personal level. I want to ask you what you do to recover when you feel disoriented or unmotivated, if you ever do that is?
Well, I don't often feel unmotivated. And I've been, you know, incredibly lucky. You know, my first career at Microsoft was, you know, totally engaging, and although there were plenty of setbacks overall, very, very successful. Now to work in the foundation, you know, because we work on a broad set of crops, a broad set of diseases, and we do some work in education as well, you know, we're always making progress on some area. You know, there are things that are negative. If you look right now at the budgets of a lot of the rich countries, not as much Korea, but almost every other well-off country, the budgets are very tight. And it's leading to many of those countries to actually cutting their aid, that is the money that they make available to help the poorest in the world. And it's very unfortunate because when they make those cuts, that means you buy less vaccines, you buy less seeds. Mm-hmm. You know, Japan's been cutting a lot. People, you know, Germany cut, France cut, Spain, you know, a lot of different places. A few places have been increasing, UK, Australia, Korea, and so on balance, you know, it might work out. But something like that is a little negative. And we just have to deal with it. Certainly when you work in scientific areas, we hit dead ends of things that don't work. You know, we worked on a malaria vaccine, and although it was effective, it was only partially effective. And so now we're actually having to go back and do a new vaccine. The AIDS vaccine field, there was a lot of excitement, but, you know, as yet, even the constructs that have been tested aren't good enough. So some of these things, you have to be fairly patient, and particularly where there's governments involved, whether it's the rich world governments or the governments in the poorer countries that often through corruption or mismanagement can take, you know, for example, and not get the vaccines delivered out to the children. And so, you know, sometimes when I visit Africa, what I see is disorganization, or I see, you know, where corruption's holding things back. That's not the overall picture, but certainly there are programs and places where that's a problem, despite the overall positive trend. You know, for me, I read lots of books, watch DVDs, play tennis, play bridge, you know, talk to my children who are quite young and aren't worried about the same problems I'm worried about. And, you know, so overall, it's pretty easy to be optimistic and enjoy all the things I get to do.
All right.
Hi, my name is Minnie, and I'm from veterinary student. My question is, I'm interested in starting a company and also, like, making financial profit and also helping society. For my interest, I'm really interested in animal rights. So can you give some advice for that?
Well, in terms of, you know, how you give back to society, you know, just starting a company that employs people and comes up with a good product, that alone, you know, serves a very, very positive social role. And then you have to decide, is it through the actions of that company that you're going to give back, or do you take whatever resources you got through that work and use that to give back in another area? You know, it's always good to pick a cause, and you know, because you've already picked a cause, it's great. You know, you can always be learning, okay, which countries handle this well? You know, how did that work? What sort of nonprofit groups are there already out there? You know, how do you get other people interested in this issue? What is it that might draw them in? You know, what does it take in terms of financial resources to create a shelter or create new rules? Or that's not an area I know very well, but it's definitely a worthy area. So I think it's great when people pick, because some people want to give back. The very fact that there's so many things to pick from, it kind of makes them hesitate, because you know, say you pick you know, vaccination, or you pick, you know, helping farmers, whatever it is, you may not pick the perfect thing, but in a sense, that's okay. You know, no one person is going to get to do all of these things, and that's the beauty of you know, having a diversity and having through the internet, everybody can find people who pick something similar. You know, I doubt you'll, you know, I don't know that there's a profit model working in the animal rights area where you can have your cake and eat it too. You know, but that's the kind of thing you should definitely explore.
All right, thank you. Well, we have about 3 minutes left, so this may be the, say, last question. So, oh yeah, with yellow jacket.
Hello. My name is Duhiri, and I'm a student of computer science. And I made so many IT services for this university. Non-official lecture evaluation system, snuev.com. Ninety percent of students use my service. Oh. Yeah. Okay. And professor hate my service. And I made so many IT services like SNU Life. And now I want to make a new company. And I have to take a coursework. So do I have to king my coursework now?
If your company, you know, if you know you're going to succeed in doing the company, then the coursework's not that important. You know, there's a view that if you get do your coursework and finish your degree, then in a sense, you're always employable. Whereas if you drop out and don't get a degree, you know, then if your company doesn't go well, you know. In the case of Harvard, I was on leave and I could have gone back any time. You know, I don't know if you can just go on leave, you know. That gives you sort of both the best of both worlds, because you can go, and then if the company succeeds, maybe you just do that, otherwise you go back. But I don't know, I mean, unless the thing you're trying to do the company for, unless that opportunity is going to disappear, there's a lot to be said for staying around, because university is a very nice time in terms of, you know, hanging out with other students and, you know, and it's very hard once you go out into the work world. It's very rare to get back into this type of environment where you're with so many other people thinking about different ideas. You know, so you know, I think you have good choices. I don't think you could go wrong either way. If you're able to create services like that, you've got some very marketable talents.
Okay. Well, I'm sure you have said many other questions, but unfortunately, he's also on a very tight schedule this time. So maybe next time he'll have another chance to come visit and have, say, more free time to discuss about, say, many different, say, issues. So this will conclude the session. And the audience, please join me in thanking Bill for his time and effort. So thank you.
Thank you. Have fun.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.